very warm welcome to all of you, to Srimati Jayalakshmi Ramachandran, Sri Ramachandran and Sri K.R. Krishnaswamy Memorial Endowment Program. Today we have a very distinguished scholar, Dr. S. Ranganath, to speak on universal peace in Mahabharata. A few words about the persons in whose honor this endowment has been established. Shrita K. Ramachandran Ravaru, June 15, 1922, Janisidaru. Ivaru Bengalurina, Vondu Astika Sampradaya Kutubundrali, Janisidaru. Ivara Adhina, Central College Nali, Mysuru Vishwavidyanilayadinda Padavi, Kelakala Nirudyogada Yatanayannu Anubhavisidaru. ನಂತರ ಗುಮಾಸ್ತರಗಿರಿ ಶೀಘ್ರಲಿಪಿ ಕಾರ್ಯಾಲಯಕ್ಕೆ ಅವರು ತಮ್ಮ ವೃತ್ತಿಯನ್ನು ಆರಂಭಿಸಿದರು. ಆದರೆ ತುಂಬ ಕ್ಷಿಪ್ರವಾಗಿ ತಮ್ಮ ಸತತವಾದ ಪರಿಶ್ರಮದ ಕಾರಣದಿಂದ ಅತಿ ಉನ್ನತವಾದಂತಹ ವ್ಯಾಸಂಗವನ್ನು ಕೈಗೊಂಡರು. 1946ರಿಂದ 1942ರವರೆಗೆ ವೇಲ್ಸ್ ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾಲಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಅವರಿಗೆ ಉನ್ನತವಾದ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಲಭಿಸಿತು. ವೈಯಕ್ತಿಕ ಜೀವನದ ಮಾರ್ಪಾಟಿಗೆ ಇದು ನಾಂದಿಯಾಯಿತು. ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕಾಲ ಬರ್ಮಾದ ರಂಗೂನ್ ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾಲಯದಲ್ಲಿಯೂ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸಕರಾಗಿ ತಮ್ಮ ವೃತ್ತಿಯನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸಿದರು. ಅನಂತರ ಐಎಎಸ್ ಸೇವೆಯಲ್ಲಿ ನೇಮಕರಾದರು. ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಮತ್ತು ಸಮಾಜ ಕಲ್ಯಾಣ ಕ್ಷೇತ್ರಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಸೇವೆ ಸಲ್ಲಿಸಲು ಅವರಿಗೆ ಅಪಾರವಾದಂತಹ ಅವಕಾಶಗಳು ಲಭಿಸಿದ್ದವು. ಮೈಸೂರು ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾಲಯದ ಕುಲ ಸಚಿವರಾಗಿಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಅವರು ಕೆಲಕಾಲ ತಮ್ಮ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯವನ್ನು ನಿರ್ವಹಿಸಿದರು. ಕರ್ನಾಟಕ ರಾಜ್ಯ ಸರ್ಕಾರದ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಇಲಾಖೆಯ ಕಾರ್ಯದರ್ಶಿಗಳಾಗಿಯೂ, ಬೆಳಗಾಂ ವಿಭಾಗಾಧಿಕಾರಿಗಳಾಗಿಯೂ, ಆಮೇಲೆ ಕೇಂದ್ರ ಸರ್ಕಾರದ ಸಮಾಜ ಕಲ್ಯಾಣ ಇಲಾಖೆಯ ಸಹ ಕಾರ್ಯದರ್ಶಿಗಳಾಗಿಯೂ ಅವಿರತವಾಗಿ ತಮ್ಮ ಸೇವೆಯನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸಿದರು. ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಮ್ಯಾನೇಜ್ಮೆಂಟ್ನ ಡೀನ್ ಆಗಿ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಆಡಳಿತಗಾರರಾಗಿಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಕೆಲಸವನ್ನು ನಿರ್ವಹಿಸಿದರು. ಕರ್ನಾಟಕದ ಸ್ವಯಂ ಸೇವಾ ಏಜೆನ್ಸಿಗಳ ಸಮನ್ವಯ ಸಮಿತಿಯ ಅಧ್ಯಕ್ಷರಾಗಿ, ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನ ಮಹಾರಾಣಿ ಲಕ್ಷ್ಮೀ ಅಮ್ಮಣಿ ಮಹಿಳಾ ಕಾಲೇಜಿನ ಟ್ರಸ್ಟ್ನ ಉಪಾಧ್ಯಕ್ಷರಾಗಿಯೂ ಕೂಡ ತಮ್ಮ ಕರ್ತವ್ಯವನ್ನು ನಿರ್ವಹಿಸಿದರು. ಇದೇ ಸಂಸ್ಥೆಯ ಅಂದರೆ ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಕಲ್ಚರ್ನ ಅಧ್ಯಕ್ಷರಾಗಿ ಸುಮಾರು 10 ವರ್ಷಕ್ಕಿಂತಲೂ ಹೆಚ್ಚು ಕಾಲ ಅವರು ತಮ್ಮ ಸೇವೆಯನ್ನು ಸಲ್ಲಿಸಿದರು. ಅವರ ಸ್ಮರಣಾರ್ಥವಾಗಿಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮವನ್ನು ಏರ್ಪಡಿಸಲಾಗಿದೆ. ಅವರು 19 ಸೆಪ್ಟೆಂಬರ್ 2008ರಂದು ದೈವಾಧೀನರಾದರು. ಅವರ ಶ್ರೀಮತಿಯವರಾದಂತಹ ಜಯಲಕ್ಷ್ಮಿಯವರು ಮೈಸೂರಿನ ಹೊಸಕೋಟೆ ಗ್ರಾಮದಲ್ಲಿ ಅಕ್ಟೋಬರ್ 10, 1933ರಲ್ಲಿ ಜನಿಸಿದರು. ಅವರ ಶಿಕ್ಷಣ ಮೈಸೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿಯೇ ಆಯಿತು. 65ರಲ್ಲಿ ಶ್ರೀ ಕೆ.ಆರ್. ರಾಮಚಂದ್ರನ್ ರವರನ್ನು ಮದುವೆಯಾದರು. ಸಂಗೀತ, ಅದರಲ್ಲೂ ಭಕ್ತಿ ಸಂಗೀತದಲ್ಲಿ ಅವರು ಅತೀವ ಆಸಕ್ತರಾಗಿದ್ದರು. ವಿಶಾಲ ಮನಸ್ಕರು, ದೈವಭಕ್ತರು ಆಗಿದ್ದ ಅವರು ದೀನದಲಿತರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ವಿಶೇಷ ಕಾಳಜಿ ವಹಿಸುತ್ತಿದ್ದರು. ಅವರು ಫೆಬ್ರವರಿ 3, 1997ರಲ್ಲಿ ದೈವಾಧೀನರಾದರು. ಅವರ ಸ್ಮರಣಾರ್ಥವಾಗಿಯೂ ಕೂಡ ಈ ಕಾರ್ಯಕ್ರಮ ಇವತ್ತು ನಡೀತಾ ಇದೆ. ಶ್ರೀಯುತ ಕೆ.ಆರ್. ಕೃಷ್ಣಸ್ವಾಮಿಯವರು ಅವರದೊಂದು ವಿಶೇಷವಾದಂತಹ ವ್ಯಕ್ತಿತ್ವ. ಬೆಂಗಳೂರಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಮಾರ್ಚ್ 12, 1916ರಂದು ಜನಿಸಿದರು. ಮೈಸೂರು ವಿಶ್ವವಿದ್ಯಾಲಯದಿಂದ ಗಣಿತ ಆನರ್ಸ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಪದವಿಯನ್ನು ಪಡೆದರು. ಇಂಡಿಯನ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಿಟ್ಯೂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಆಕ್ಚುರೀಸ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಶಿಷ್ಯ ವೇತನವನ್ನು ಪಡೆದರು. 1937ರಿಂದ 1955ರವರೆಗೆ ಸುಮಾರು 18 ವರ್ಷಗಳ ಕಾಲ ಪುಣೆಯ ಮೆಟೆರಾಲಜಿಕಲ್ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ನಲ್ಲಿ ಸೇವೆ ಸಲ್ಲಿಸಿದರು. ನಂತರ ಕಲ್ಕತ್ತಾದ ನ್ಯಾಷನಲ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟ್ರೂಮೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟರಿಯಲ್ಲಿ 1974ರವರೆಗೆ ಸೇವೆ ಸಲ್ಲಿಸಿ ನಿವೃತ್ತರಾದರು. ಮುಂದೆ 5 ವರ್ಷಗಳ ಕಾಲ ಸ್ವಯಂ ಸಂತೃಪ್ತಿಗಾಗಿ ವಿದ್ಯಾರ್ಥಿಗಳಿಗೆ ಸಂಸ್ಕೃತ ಮತ್ತು ಗಣಿತವನ್ನು ಬೋಧಿಸಿದರು. ಶಂಕರರ ವಿವೇಕ ಚೂಡಾಮಣಿಯನ್ನು ಒಳಗೊಂಡಂತೆ ವೇದಾಂತ, ಭಾರತೀಯ ತತ್ವಜ್ಞಾನ, ಧರ್ಮ ಇತ್ಯಾದಿ ಅನೇಕ ವಿಷಯಗಳ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಕೂಲಂಕಷವಾಗಿ ನಿಶ್ಚಿತ ಮತಿಯಿಂದ ಉಪನ್ಯಾಸಗಳನ್ನು ನೀಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು. ಅವರ ಆಂಗ್ಲ ಗ್ರಂಥ ಆದಿಶಂಕರ ವಿವೇಕ ಚೂಡಾಮಣಿ ಮರಣೋತ್ತರವಾಗಿ 1999ರಲ್ಲಿ ಅವರ ಕುಟುಂಬದವರಿಂದ ಪ್ರಕಟವಾಯಿತು. ಈ ಸಮಾರಂಭಕ್ಕೆ ಅವರ ಕುಟುಂಬ ವರ್ಗದವರಿಗೂ ಮತ್ತೆ ಅವರ ಹಿತೈಷಿಗಳಿಗೂ ಕೂಡ ಹೃತ್ಪೂರ್ವಕವಾದಂತಹ ಸ್ವಾಗತವನ್ನ ಬಯಸ್ತೇನೆ. ಟುಡೇಸ್ ಟಾಕ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಆನ್ ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಲ್ ಪೀಸ್ ಇನ್ ಮಹಾಭಾರತ. ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್, ಆಸ್ ಐ ಸೆಡ್ ಅರ್ಲಿಯರ್, ಒನ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಡಿಸ್ಟಿಂಗ್ವಿಶ್ಡ್ ಸ್ಕಾಲರ್ಸ್ ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಎಸ್ ರಂಗನಾಥ್ ಟು ಡೆಲಿವರ್ ದ ಟಾಕ್. ಡಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಎಸ್ ರಂಗನಾಥ್ ಸೆಕ್ಯೂರ್ಡ್ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ಕ್ಲಾಸ್ ಫಸ್ಟ್ ರ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಇನ್ ಎಂ ಎ ಸಾನ್ಸ್ಕ್ರಿಟ್ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಯೂನಿವರ್ಸಿಟಿ. ಹಿ ಈಸ್ ದ ರೆಸಿಪಿಯಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಹಿರಿಯಣ್ಣ ಗೋಲ್ಡ್ ಮೆಡಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಫೆಬ್ಬಾರ್ ಶ್ರೀವೈಷ್ಣವ ಸಭಾ ಗೋಲ್ಡ್ ಮೆಡಲ್. ದ ಟೈಟಲ್ ವೇದ ಭೂಷಣ ವಾಸ್ ಕನ್ಫರ್ಡ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ಹಿಮ್ ಬೈ ವೇದ ಧರ್ಮ ಪರಿಪಾಲನಾ ಸಭಾ. ದ ಟೈಟಲ್ ವೇದಶ್ರೀ ವಾಸ್ ಕನ್ಫರ್ಡ್ ಅಪಾನ್ ಹಿಮ್ ಬೈ ದ ವರ್ಲ್ಡ್ ಅಸೋಸಿಯೇಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ವೇದಿಕ್ ಸ್ಟಡೀಸ್ ಯುಎಸ್ಎ ಬ್ಯಾಂಗ್ಲೂರ್ ಬ್ರಾಂಚ್. American Biographical Institute, USA has honored him with the title The Man of the Year 1996. He holds a Vidwat degree in Advaita Vedanta from Sri Chamarajendra Sanskrit College, Bangalore. He studied Rig Veda traditionally for a period of 8 years. In fact, he has the ability to chant the suktas with the right intonation with not a single mistake or error in pronunciation. His PhD dissertation was a contribution of Vachaspati Mishra to Indian philosophy. He has 90 books and more than 100 research papers to his credit. A big hand to his academic achievements. He is presently professor and head of the Department of Sanskrit at NMP Army College for Women, which is an autonomous college. And he is also the director of Arvi Institute of Sanskrit Studies. He was awarded D.Litt from Himachal Pradesh University, Shimla in 2005 for his postdoctoral publications on post-independence Sanskrit literature. In fact, he is one of the living authorities on this part of Sanskrit literature. Of course, he is extraordinarily good in other parts also, but he is a very distinguished, accepted authority on post-independent Sanskrit literature. He is nominated as a subject expert to Adarsha Sanskrit Vidyapitha, Madhurantakam, Tamil Nadu. He has a Rashtrabhasha Visharada in Hindi from Chennai. He delivered lectures at Oxford, Cambridge, London, Brighton, Nottingham, Berlin and Wittenberg during June-July 2011 on Indian culture. He was honored at House of Commons, Parliament of London by Lord Billy Moria. Her Royal Highness Princess Mahachakri Sirindhon honored him at Shilpakarn University, Bangkok, Thailand on 27th September 2013. Honorable Chief Minister of Karnataka, Shri Siddaramaiya presented him the book prize for the year 2012-13 as the best book on Gandhi, entitled Gandhi in Sanskrit Literature at Gandhi Bhavan, Bangalore on 2nd October 2013. He has been nominated as a Kannada language expert for Multilingual Sanskrit Etymological Dictionary Project by Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India in January 2014. He was awarded Vachaspati by Rashtriya Sanskrit Vidyapeeth Tirupati on 5th March 2014 at their 17th convocation. He was awarded Adhyatma Vidya Alankara on 30th April 2014 at Shankar Krupa, Bangalore. Shankar Shastri Trust, Bangalore honored him as an eminent Vedic scholar on 22nd November 2015. He was honored at Kashi on 20th November 2016 with Vagyoga Sanman by Vagyoga Chetana Peetham. He is a member jury for the selection of Central Sahitya Academy Awards for Sanskrit for 2016-17. Sahitya Academy, on behalf of Ministry of Culture, Government of India, nominated him to participate in a seminar on influence of Sanskrit on Southeast Asian languages. And the pinnacle of glory was Akhila Bharatiya Vidwat Parishad Kashi has conferred the title Mahamahopadhyaya on him for the year 2017. It is the highest title for any Sanskrit scholar in the world. With these few words of introduction, I extend a very warm welcome to Professor S. Ranganath. In fact, the introduction is only a very brief summary of what his achievements are. So I once again welcome him to this program. The topic on which we'll be speaking is universal peace in Mahabharata. In today's context, this is a very topical subject, basically because somehow we have been, as just now Mr. Ramprakash was pointing it out, peace has been the short pause between two wars. Very unfortunate that it is. That is the reality. So I'm sure Dr. Ranganath will dwell on this subject, taking excerpts from the Mahabharata, which is really a kind of an encyclopedia on Indian thought, on all aspects of life. I also extend a very warm welcome to all of you who are present here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. R. N. Nagaraj, for having been so kind enough to introduce me to this elite audience. At the very outset, I am grateful to the donors of this particular endowment lecture, on whose munificence I have been here. I am also grateful to the members of Indian Institute of World Culture, and especially Sri Ramprakash, who has been here, whom I had seen even when I delivered B.P. Wadia Memorial Lectures in 1987, October 2nd, October 3rd and October 4th, which has been published in the form of transaction number 77, 78 and 79 on Rigveda. And I am grateful to all of you for making your presence here. The topic which has been associated for this evening's lecture is of seminal importance, because peace is something which everybody wants, but exactly that is the one which is deluding everyone. So from that context, especially in the modern world, we have unfortunately only PIECE and we don't have PESE. Therefore, peace is the most sought after thing in the modern world. For the sake of my convenience, I have divided this lecture into three parts. In the first part, I am going to highlight how peace is the need of the hour from the point of view of various religions. In the second half, I will be dealing something about uniqueness, greatness of Mahabharata, which is known as the fifth Veda. And in the third part of my lecture, I will just take out at random one or two statements from Mahabharata and show how exactly peace is the primary concern of Mahabharata. This is the general framework in which I want to start today's lecture. Peace is the most sought after thing by every person in the world, and it's the same that has always been deluding in him. Irrespective of the world, religions like Buddhism, Christianity, Confucianism, Hinduism, Islam, Jainism, Judaism, Shintoism, Sikhism, Taoism, Zoroastrianism and Baha'i faiths have universally advocated universal peace, which could be gleaned through some of the following statements. According to Buddhism, true happiness comes to those who live at peace with their fellow beings. The aim of all should be to learn peace and to live peacefully with all men. According to Christianity, Jesus is the Prince of Peace. He came to this earth to bring peace to all men. The peacemaker is blessed and shall be a child of God. We should seek the way of peace and finally come to peace with God. According to Confucianism, seek to live in harmony with all your neighbors and at peace with thy brethren. Peace and love should reign throughout the world. The Most High God seeks peace among all the people. According to Hinduism, if one would find happiness and security, one must seek for peace. The peaceful mind will become established in wisdom. The most important thing for a man is to have wisdom. What demarcates man from a beast is really the wisdom. knowledge comes, but wisdom lingers, as Tennyson would have it. Bertrand Russell, in History of Western Philosophy, states, with the oncoming of civilization, culture has receded back. With the people becoming more and more intelligent, they are lagging behind in wisdom, and for wisdom, we have to turn to India. This is what Russell states. According to Islam, God will guide men to peace. If they will heed him, he will lead them from the darkness of war to the light of peace. According to Jainism, the enlightened will make peace the foundation of their lives. All men should live in peace with their fellow beings. This is the Lord's desire, live and let live. That is the principle of Jainism. According to Judaism, it looks forward to an ideal time when peace shall reign supreme throughout the world. God commends peace and urges all his followers to work for peace. The peaceful life offers the greatest opportunity for happiness and prosperity. Just 15 minutes ago, my good friend R.N. Nagaraj was reciting one verse which comes to my mind now. Everybody wants happiness, but we are not in a position to acquire that happiness because we have not done that kind of punya. Nobody wants unhappiness, but invariably we do bad acts so that we incur unhappiness. Punyasya palamichanti or dharmasya palamichanti, punyam nechanti manavaha, papasya palam nechanti, papam kurvanti yatnataha. That is the sad part of our lives. According to Sikhism, the true norm is my support, is my food and drink. By it, my hunger of every kind is satisfied. By saturating my mind, it has satisfied all my longings and given me peace and happiness. According to Taoism, the wise esteem peace and quiet above all else. The good ruler seeks peace and not war, and he rules by persuasion rather by force. You know, we have the great work War and Peace amidst us, which is very voluminous and at the same time, which is very relevant. According to Baha'i faith, today there is no greater glory for man than that of service in the cause of the most great peace. You know, according to Swami Vivekananda, they alone live who live for others. Those who live only for themselves are more dead than alive. Therefore, one who lives for others, he alone lives. Peace is light, whereas war is darkness. Peace is life, war is death. Peace is guidance, war is error. Peace is the foundation of God, war is a satanic institution. Peace is the illumination of the world of humanity, war is the destroyer of human foundations. Now, according to our own culture, we have got Shanti Mantras in our Veda. There are 10 Shanti Mantras which categorically describe how we have to live in peace, not only with ourselves, but even with nature. We are trying to harm nature, and now the ecosystem has totally changed because we are the sole and whole responsible for that. We cannot blame the nature because we have played with nature, we are trying to affect nature, and we are trying to destroy nature, therefore in turn we are getting destroyed. Therefore, we alone are responsible for the present situation and we can't shift the responsibility to others. In Vedas, we have the statement, Prithivi Shanti, Agni Shanti, Oshada Yash Shanti, Vanaspata Yash Shanti, Vayu Shanti, Brahma Shanti, Brahmana Shanti, Nakshatrani Shanti, Shantir Me Astu Shanti. What have they left? Tell me. Everything in nature they have covered. Let there be peace. Let earth be peaceful. She is peaceful with Agni, so that there will be no earthquakes. May the earth who is peaceful remove my miseries. There are three kinds of miseries, Adhyatmik, Adidaivik and Adibhautik. In fact, the very first karika of Ishvara Krishna's Sankhya karika starts with that. Dukkha Trayavigata Jignasa Tadabhagatake Hetau Drushte Sapartache Naikartataha Atyantato Abhavat. The sky is peaceful. It is peaceful with air because let there be no hurricane wind. We are playing for the air. We have got a great lesson to learn from air. from the point of view of universality. Air or wind blows on a crematorium, it also blows on a garden. It does not make any distinction that I have to blow only on garden and not on crematorium. Sarva samabhava, that is what the moralistic lesson we have to learn from the wind. May the peaceful Dyuloka remove my miseries. Let the earth be peaceful, let the sky be peaceful, let all the quarters be peaceful, let the subquarters be peaceful, may the Agni be peaceful. Why? Because let there be no earthquakes and volcanoes. May the stars be peaceful. You know, there is an ugly joke. Stars scintillate. Sin stars scintillate. May the waters be peaceful. May the hearth be peaceful. May the big trees be peaceful. May the cow be peaceful. May the goat be peaceful. May the horse be peaceful. May the man be peaceful. Let there be peace to me from peace. Let the wealth, shyness, firmness, penance, intelligence, firm establishment, all these confer peace on me. This Shanti Mantra, which is in the form of a prayer for Shanti from the five great elements and the sun, has special relevance and importance to the present day world. The calamities caused by the five elements, such as earthquakes, droughts, heavy rains, floods, fire accidents, storms and cyclones, which occur periodically in every part of the world, are well known. Sky has been having its own role by providing space for the movement of all these four elements. Now there are different types of threats besides those mentioned above from these elements. The process of slow self-poisoning of the people is going on by the use of fertilizers, full of various chemicals and insecticides, which may, in course of time, make, as the scientists fear, the land barren. Thus, the Shanti on the earth is badly affected. The fire in the form of electricity, which runs many factories, has become a great source of pollution along with the air, which spreads it. In this polluted atmosphere, even the directly held rainwater is not free from suspected pollution. Some of the countries have plans to establish their colonies in the space, affecting thereby the peace even in the sky with the talk of star war. The sky has already been emitting TV pollution through the satellites flying around the globe. The sun is likely to disturb peace by piercing through the ozone layer with its rays. There may be a sudden lunar effect on somebody who may immediately order the use of nuclear weapons throughout the missiles which have been waiting to fly through the sky in all directions. This Shanti Mantra should be dinned to save the world into the ears of all the members of the United Nations, of those who hold key positions in the countries termed superpowers. Once these great persons sincerely think of world peace without selfishness and egotistic impulses, they are sure to find the ways for the world peace. They may direct the same scientists who were asked to engage themselves in producing destructive weapons to find out constructive measures to safeguard the peace in all the five elements. In fact, the scientists may have a very limited role in achieving this goal. The religious leaders, sociologists, historians, pundits of political science and philosophers have a very important role to play, because it's only these people who can completely remove the mental pollution that has been plaguing the humanity ever since the science has taken an upper hand over humanities. Branding everything that is beyond the understanding as superstitious, introducing from time to time its own scientific superstition to be discarded within a short time by another superstition. One does good if one remembers Bacon's words. There is superstition in avoiding superstition. Swami Dayananda opined that where there is no peace, there is no limit of sufferings. Spinoza remarked that peace is not absence of war, it is a virtue, a state of mind, a disposition for benevolence, confidence and justice. Albert Einstein claimed that peace cannot be kept by force. It can only be achieved by understanding. James Thompson remarks that peace is the happy natural state of man. War is corruption and disgrace. In this background, I come to Mahabharata. This is the second part of my lecture. You know, Mahabharata has been considered as the fifth Veda. What you find in Mahabharata, you can find elsewhere. What you don't find in Mahabharata, you can't find anywhere else. Yadihasti tadanyatra, yan nehasti natat kvachit, bharataha panchamo vedaha. Therefore, it is called the fifth Veda. Mahatvecha gurutvecha driyamanam yatodikam, mahatva bharavatvacha Mahabharata muchyate. By sheer volume, as well as by sheer wisdom, there is no other work which can match Mahabharata. Yatha samudro bhagavan, yatha cha himavan girihi, khyato ubhau ratna nidhi, tatha bharata muchyate. Just as there is no corresponds with ocean. How is ocean? Ocean is like an ocean. Ocean is not a river. Ocean is not a rivulet. Ocean is not a pond. Ocean is not a lake. Ocean is not a tap. How is the ocean? Ocean is like an ocean. How is the sky? Sky is like the sky. How was the war between Rama and Ravana? It was like the war between Rama and Ravana. So also, how is Mahabharata? Mahabharata is like Mahabharata. That's all. You cannot give another parallel to show how Mahabharata is, because it's unparalleled, unique, ubiquitous, and one of its kind. Dharmecha, Artecha, Kamecha, Mokshecha, Varadarshava, Yirihasti Tadanyatra, Yennehasti Nadatpachita. You can find all the four Purusharthas here. In fact, the very first stanza of Bhagavad Gita starts with the term Dharma. Dharma Kshetre, Kurukshetre, Samaveta, Yuyutsava, Mavaka Pandavaschaiva, Kivakurvata Sanjaya. According to Swami Ranganathananda's interpretation, if you remove the common factor, what remains is Kshetre, Kshetre, Dharmam Kuru. Wherever you are, you do your Dharma. What is the Dharma of a student? Is to learn well. What is the Dharma of a teacher? Is to teach well. Because in these days, we have got three kinds of teachers. Some of us, we are outstanding teachers because we always stand outside the classroom. Some of us, we are rare teachers because rarely we take classes. And there's a third category where we are classed by ourselves because nobody ever attends our classes. We'll be all alone in the classroom. So in this state, we want gurus of the caliber of Drishti Matra Guru like Ramana, Alingana Matra Guru like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, Sparsha Matra Guru like Chandrasekhara Bharati Mahaswamigal, the 34th Jagat Guru of Sringeri Sharada Peetham, and not the ordinary kind of teachers as we are, including me. So now there are five ratnas in Mahabharata. Pancha ratnani bharate. The word ratna, I recollect the name of Rajaratnam. You know, original name of Rajaratnam was Rajayingar. Once his teacher scolded, "Ivarella ratnagalu mundeyavu yenu arthagala." Immediately he changed the word Ayengar and put Ratna and said that, "I will show to the world how I am not a Ratna." So that is how Rajayingar became Rajaratnam. He was living in 17th cross, 3rd main road, 38 door number, Videha house, and who banged on my back 37 years ago and told me, "Please speak slowly. You are very fast." I said yes, but I did not follow. What to do? I start with narrow gauge, it goes to broad gauge. So that is one of my defects. Gita, the very first Ratna is Gita, Bhagavad Gita. Gita Sugita Kartavya Kimanyai Shastra Vistarai. Tadidam Gita Shastram Samasta Vedartha Sara Sangraha Bhutam. This is Shankaracharya's commentary on Gita. And if you interchange the word Gita, Gita, Gita 10 times, it becomes Tyagi. That's the interpretation of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. Gita is nothing but Tyaga. So, do Tyaga by studying Gita. That is Ramakrishna's version. And Professor S.K. Ramachandra as well as Swami Rama, they discuss psychological aspect of Gita. And they go to the extent of calling that Arjuna was a psychotic patient and Krishna was a counselor. That's the interpretation they take. You know, there are so many interpretations of Bhagavad Gita. In fact, Edwin Arnold calls it as song celestial. The whole thing is a song. It's a Lord's song. So, if Christ is the Son of God, if Muhammad is the messenger of God, Krishna is God incarnate. This is according to Pandit Raja N.T. Srinivas Iyengar, who taught me Bhagavad Gita 42 years ago in his house in Rangarao Road. So, Gita. Second one is Sahasranama. What is Sahasranama? Vishnu Sahasranama. You see, it is so popular a work. Vishnu Sahasranama has got so many commentaries. And probably the greatest commentary in 20th century on Vishnu Sahasranama is of 2000 pages of magnitude in Sanskrit, wherein every word of Vishnu Sahasranama has been justified with the help of four Vedas. There is a scholastic commentary written on Bhagavad Gita with on Vishnu Sahasranama with such a elaborate commentary. Satyadev Vasishth, who lived in Rohtak near Delhi, 73 kilometers from Delhi, and in 1997 January 2nd, when 10th World Sanskrit Conference was held in Tharalabadu Kendra, RT Nagar, he handed over that copy to me to translate. I took 10 years to translate 2000 pages, and in English it came to 4000 pages. Naturally, when you put Sanskrit thing into English, you cannot word to word translate it, because you have to get the gist of it and express it in your own sentences. So that has been published from Eastern Booklinkers, 5825 New Chandrabal, Jawahar Nagar, Delhi, 11007, 4 years ago. So, what I want to say in this context is, Sahasranama is that where you have 1000 names for each god. Stavaraja, Bhishma Stavaraja. You know, that's a great work. There are only two people who could conquer senses. One is Hanuman, another one is Bhishma. They are the only two people who have conquered their senses. Anyatra Bhishmat Gangeyat, Anyatra cha Hanumataha, Harinikura Matrena, Charmana Mohitan Jagat. That's the popular statement. So from entire Ramayana I have got Hanuman, from entire Mahabharata I have got Bhishma. They are the only two people who could conquer their senses. We can conquer others, but we cannot conquer ourselves. That's the most important thing. Who am I? That's the basic question. Just now Nagaraj introduced me for nearly 5 minutes. That's why I usually tell, please don't read my bio data. So the third thing is Anusmriti. You know, after Bhagavad Gita, we also have got Anusmriti, then Gajendra Moksha. So, these are the five great jewels of Mahabharata. Originally, it was written for 24,000 stanzas on par with Ramayana. You know, Ramayana is also 24,000 stanzas. And critically, if you study Ramayana, after every 1000 stanzas, you get a letter of Gayatri Mantra. Therefore, entire Ramayana is nothing but an elaboration of 24 letters of Gayatri Mantra into 24,000 stanzas. And according to another thing, in Sundarakanda, every stanza starts from Sa or Ta, because Sita is the main character. Tato Ravana Nitaya Sitaya Chatrukarshana Yesha Padam Anveshtum Charana Charite Pati Sita Sita Sita. It goes on like that. So that's how one has to critically peruse into our traditional works. In this particular Mahabharata, we have got famous Upakhyanas. You know, Nalopakhyana. One of the most famous Upakhyanas in the entire Mahabharata, Nala and Damayanti. So, Pancha Nadiya Prasanga. Five people, they appear in the form of Nala. Now, who is the real Nala? Devapatir Vishnu Nayishadara Jagatya Nirniyate Nakimana Priyate Bhavatya Nayam Nalostitavati Mahanalabo Yatyena Muchasinarakkatara Paraste 34th stanza 13th canto Naishadiya Charita Shri Harsha who belonged to Kanyakupcha and who is known as Naishadam Vidvadaushadam. So whoever can understand Naishada Kavya, they are the real scholars. Anybody can by heart Kumar Sambhava and Raghuvamsa, but those who can by heart entire Naishadiya Charita, 24 cantos and 2432 stanzas, that is a mark of scholarship in those days when we used to participate in Antyakshari competition of only Mahakavyas and not speaking anything about other lower Kavyas, including Stotra Kavya and Anushtubh stanzas, as being held in Delhi in 1976 when I represented Sanskrit College and got the first prize, having by heart 200 stanzas for every letter. Ma, Ta and Va. That is how always the stanzas will end. If you say 199 stanzas, I will recite 200 stanzas from the Ma and I will win. That was the kind of challenging spirit I had in those days. Anyway, now also 100 stanzas yen mosa illa. Avaga 300 bartha itto onnond akshrakke 100 ke yen mosa illa vayasagoyte yen madu. Poor memory. So, Nalopakhyana. And you have got five ideal couple. You see, Bata people, they advertise pair for pairs. Pair, husband and wife go to the Bata shop and get pair of slippers and walk out. Therefore, they advertise pair for pairs. Here, Lisha Shashankam. The first ideal combination is moon and the night. Shivaya Girisham, Shiva Parvati. Shriya Harim, Lakshmi and Narayana. Fourth one is Savitri and Satyavan. Fifth one is Nala and Damayanti. They are the ideal couples in our tradition. Then you have got Shakuntala Upakhyana, the most famous thing. You know, Kalidasa made so many remarkable changes, including the curse of Durvasa. Otherwise, the whole drama would have been useless without the curse. Having married Dushyanta says, I don't know who you are in front of Shakuntala. What a kind of hero he would have been. And you have got Savitri Upakhyana. What a fine thing. You see, Savitri challenged Yama. And Yama was so pleased that he said, you ask any of the three boons other than the life of your husband. She said, I want to have children from Satyavan. Yama thought he himself is very clever, but Savitri caught him. Samanva Hengasri Jasti Buddhi, Gandhasan Syaks already. So Savitri Upakhyana is also there. So in this particular background, we have got entire Parva called Shanti Parva in Mahabharata. You see what to say. I feel so guilty because I can't even recite one or two stanzas in this particular topic from the point of view of how Shanti has been the principal character of entire Mahabharata due to paucity of time. Kalaya Tasmai Namaha. Tridashanam Yatha Vishnu, Dvipadam Brahmano Yatha, Bhushananam Cha Sarvesham, Yatha Chudamanir Naraha, Yatha Yudanam Kurisham, Indriyanam Yatha Manaha, Tateha Sarvashastranam, Mahabharatam Uttamam. Markandeya Purana eulogizes Mahabharata like this. Just as Vishnu is greatest among gods, just as thunderbolt is greatest among all the weapons, just as mind is the greatest among all the senses, so also among all scriptures, Mahabharata is great. There are 18 parvas. You know, 18 is a very, very significant term from our point of view because symbolically that is the name term which indicates victory. Therefore, it is called Jayabharata. You know, totally there are 18 parvas in Mahabharata. In Bhagavad Gita, you have got 18 chapters. It was an 18-day war. 18 Akshauhini Sainya was there. And there are 18 Puranas in our tradition and 18 Upapuranas. Therefore, 18 is a very symbolic representation of victory, of dharma over adharma. Now, coming to this subject matter, I am quoting Stri Parva, 7th chapter, 18th verse. Yatha Indriyam Naro Rajan Krodha Lobaha Nirakrutaha Santushtaha Satyavadiyaha Saha Shanti Vadigachati. Who can get peace according to Mahabharata? The man who has restrained his passion. The most important thing is to control our desires. Desire is the root cause of misery. You know, Ashtavakra tells Janaka Maharaja in Ashtavakra Gita, Ashayaha ye dasaha, te dasaha sarva lokasya. Asha yesham dasi, te sham dasaya te lokaha. So one who has conquered desire is the real master. And he should not allow desire to conquer him. Therefore the most important thing is conquering our desires. Desire is the root cause of misery according to Buddha also. And you know the most important thing is, as H.H. Annegowda, the former professor of English and personal assistant to Kengal Hanumanthaya, gave the slogan when Hanumanthaya built Vidhan Sauda, deserve before you desire. If at all you want to desire something, you should deserve it. Undeservedly, you should not even desire for something. So that's the most important message. And you know, desire is the root cause for all the unhappy things. Kamaha, Krodaha, Lobaha, Trini Dwarani Narakasya. Clearly Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita, there are three doorways for hell. The first one is desire, second one is anger, and third one is infatuation. So these are the three doorways for hell. It's the mind which makes hell a heaven and heaven a hell, as Milton would have it. It's all there in your mind. So, Yadbhavam Tadbhavati, that's why you have that popular statement. Brahmavid Brahmaiva Bhavati. If I think that I am good, naturally no bad thoughts can ever come to me. Therefore, it all depends on who am I, what I am thinking. Because the mind is the most important thing which should be in under our control. The passions, kama. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa used to say, kama vanna gellabekadare, ಮಡದಿಯನ್ನು ತಾಯಿಯಂತೆ ಕಾಣು. ದಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ಪರಮಹಂಸ. ಯು ಟ್ರೀಟ್ ಯುವರ್ ವೈಫ್ ಆಸ್ ಯುವರ್ ಮದರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಯು ಟ್ರೀಟ್ ಆಲ್ ವಿಮೆನ್ ಆಸ್ ಯುವರ್ ಮದರ್. ಜನನೀ ಜನ್ಮಭೂಮಿಶ್ಚ ಸ್ವರ್ಗಾದಪಿ ಗರೀಯಸಿ. ಮದರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಮದರ್ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ ಆರ್ ಗ್ರೇಟರ್ ದನ್ ಹೆವನ್ ಇಟ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್. ಇಫ್ ಜೀಜಾಬಾಯ್ ಹ್ಯಾಡ್ ನಾಟ್ ಇನ್ಫ್ಲೂಯನ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಕೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ವಿಸ್ಡಮ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ದ ಮೈಂಡ್ ಆಫ್ ಶಿವಾಜಿ, ಪ್ರಾಬ್ಲಿ ಶಿವಾಜಿ ವುಡ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ನೆವರ್ ಬಿಕಮ್ ಎ ಪೇಟ್ರಿಯಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದಟ್ ಕ್ಯಾಲಿಬರ್. Therefore, the role of the mother, which is the most important thing. That's why Matra Deva Bhava comes and then Pitra Deva Bhava. Mata Purva Rupam, Pita Uttara Rupam. So, father comes next. First is mother. And subdued anger. The most important thing to do is to subdue anger. Yaro helta idru, nani kopane baralla. Yerne sala kedru, murne sala kedru. Yes, sir, adhi kopa baralla anta. Kopa baralla anta, kopa kedbutra. Yen madad nodi. The most important thing is to control anger. That's why in our VTS bus there will be a slogan. Kopavu nandida deepavagali, naguvu nanda deepavagali. Entha olle maatu, kopa nand hogbeku, alle bitbidbeku. Adan belisbitre matte doddagibidutte, eradu kai seride chappale, one kai yen madutte. Yaradu nagta idre nodak chenagirutte horatu, alta idre yen chenagirutte. You see, people should always have that kind of smiling countenance by nature. Not by going to laughter club and practice how to laugh. Naturally you should laugh. So that should be your nature. You know, if some people laugh, even there will be a dimple on their cheek. Like Preeti Zinta or Deepika Padukone or Digant for that matter. So the most important thing is that laughter, that smile. That's the most important thing. Smita. I tell my students in the first class, I don't take teaching in the first class. I just explain the meaning of the names of my students. Next day the parents come in search of me and ask me, sir, have I given such a good name to our daughter? I said, yes madam, unknowingly God makes you do good things. Knowingly means that pride will come, I did this. Unknowingly God will make you do good things. Therefore, always we should be grateful to that God who is generator, organizer and destroyer. G is generator, O is organizer, D is destroyer. Therefore God. If you don't realize God, you will be born as dog. G-O-D, D-O-G. That's all. Therefore you should have God realization. But unfortunately we have only dog realization in the modern caliber. And the most important thing to control anger. Anger is short madness. Try to control it. Otherwise it will control you. This is what Horace said in the West. If you cannot control anger, anger itself will start controlling you. Therefore, the most important thing to do is to control your anger. An angry man opens his mouth and shuts up his eyes. Cato says, once you open your mouth, you shut up your eyes. That's where you commit the mistake. Never answer a letter when you are angry. Chinese proverb. You see, one letter, if you say, you cannot say afterwards, I did not mean so. No Mino or Mosle will come to your aid. Did you or did you not say? That's the question. That's why Polonius tells Hamlet in 9th second scene, third line 42 of Shakespeare's Hamlet, a slip of the foot can be restored back, but never the slip of the tongue. Once you put a step, you can take back the step. Once you utter a word, you cannot say that I did not utter, I did not mean so. Not in that context. What is the use in thinking after? As Kabir would have it, Achayadina Pachayagaye, Jabu Chidiya Achukkayi Khet, Tab Pachitaye Kya Hovata Hai. When the birds have come and taken away the grains from the field, you start thinking, I should have put a fence, I should have stood there with a stick in my hand, I should have employed a watchman. What is the use of thinking now? Gatan Nashochayet Pragnaha Bhavishyannaiva Chintaye Vartamanena Kalena Kritakrityo Sadabhava. That's why we say that. Don't brood over the past. Don't unnecessarily get afraid of the future. Think properly and do what you can do in the present sense. Therefore, beware the fury of a patient man, Dryden says in one of the contexts. Those who never get angry, if they get angry, very difficult to control that anger. We have all faced that in Basungudi National College, 1974, when Rangapriya Swamigal in his Purvashrama H.S. Varadeshkachar was taking class in room number 8, 2:30-3:30 hour on 14th June 1974, when all the people in the first line, they smiled, oh, this old Buddha cannot speak English. On that day, 1 hour he spoke one sentence and went away. What is that inconsistent, incoherent, intolerant talk going on right before my nose? He started like that, banged for 1 hour, one sentence and walked out. That's why you should never underestimate anybody. Appearances are always deceptive. So if you think that he is like that, it's good. If you think he appears like that, it's a difficult question to solve, because next minute he will appear differently. Prompted by anger, man kills his own mother, father, brother, friends and relatives. He will often have occasion to repent of actions. Therefore, always kith and kin are nothing but kith kon thin. Always kith and kin will kith kon thin. You can trust a friend but not a relative. Dryden in one of the sonnets says, I have forgotten the name of the sonnet due to poor memory. He says, thank God, God has given me good friends, though not good relatives. You can never expect a good relative. If you are too good, they will be envious of you. If you are too bad, they will laugh at you. Therefore, either way, you will be ridiculed in that circle. Anger begins in folly and ends in repentance. This is what Pythagoras says. It always begins in folly and later you start repenting it. There is no point in repenting. You cannot change. What has been done can never be undone later. From anger comes delusion, which results in loss of memory. The loss of memory causes destruction of discrimination, and from the ruin of discrimination, the man perishes. This is Krishna's statement in Gita. Sangat sanjayate kamaha, kamat krodho vijayate, krodhat bhavati sammohaha, sammoha smriti vibramaha, smriti bramshat buddhinashaha, buddhinashat pranashyati. You can't stop in the middle. It's like Macbeth killing Duncan and say that, let me do with that. No, you cannot stop at that. You have to kill the grooms. You can't stop at that. You have to kill Banquo. Then you can't avoid ghost of Banquo haunting you. Approach me like a rugged Russian bear, armed rhinoceros or Hidden tiger, but never show thy gory locks at me. Macbeth's address to ghost of Banquo. Bellona's bridegroom turned himself into a fiendish butcher. That's the commentary of A.C. Bradley, the most reputed commentator on Shakespeare, like Mallinatha on Kalidasa. Therefore, the most important thing is, you cannot control that anger. As heat conserved is transmuted into energy, anger controlled can be transmuted into a power which can move the entire world. This is what Mahatma Gandhi says. You see, heat conserved is transmuted into energy. So anger controlled, if you can control that anger, it can transmute into a power which can move the world. Anger always causes tension. The moment you are in tension, you will lose attention. Then you are in total confusion and you will feel irritation. Then you will spoil personal relation. Ultimately, you won't get cooperation. Then you will make things complication. Then your BP may cause caution and you may have to take medication. Instead, understand the situation and try to think about the solution. Many problems will be solved by discussion, which will work out better in your profession. Don't think it's my free suggestion. It's only for your prevention. If you can understand my intention, you will never come back to tension. Therefore, the most important thing is to control that particular thing. Let me narrate one incident. I don't know whether it really happened or not. Anyway, that story is rare. And Nagaraj knows that story regarding the story of Bharavi. Bharavi was a great poet. Everybody was praising him, except his father. One day he thought, if I finish off my father, I will have only praise in the world. He stood with a huge rock in his house. He was about to put that rock on the head of his father. Then he heard the conversation between the parents. The mother used to ask, when the entire world is praising our son, why you are not praising? The father said, yes, I know the greatness of my son. If I also praise, the praise will go to his head and he will stop reading. I want to see that my son is the greatest scholar on the earth, not that I am envious and jealous about my son's scholarship. Having heard that, Bharavi thought, 1 minute if I had slipped that rock, what a fine father I would have lost. Next morning, he came to his father and asked, what is the punishment for a person who wanted to kill his own father without narrating the background? The father said immediately he has to go to his father-in-law's house and live there for a week. He did not understand what is so difficult in going to father-in-law's house. He had never gone to his father-in-law's house even after years. Unexpectedly, when the son-in-law goes, naturally a royal welcome awaited him. Milk, buttermilk, ghee started pouring in the form of a stream. 1 day, 2 days, 3 days. On the fourth day, the mother-in-law said, maybe you better take a look at the cowshed. The father-in-law said, I am going to the field, why don't you accompany me? Then he wrote a stanza, Shvashura graha nivasaha swargatulyo narana. Living in father-in-law's house is living in heaven itself. Yedi vasati dinani, trini, pancha, ata sapta. He believes for 3, 5, maximum 7 days. Dadi madhu grita kshira dhara pravahaha. Curds, milk, everything will flow towards him in the form of a stream. Tadupari dinam ekam padaraksha prayogaha. He believes for more than 7 days. What is kept in the corner of the room, that will be the kind of treatment which will be given to him. Therefore, son-in-law should always be chief, should not become cheap in the house of father-in-law. The most important thing is, whether that incident happened or not, we have got a lesson to learn from that moral. Like our Panchatantra and Hitopadesha, which are full of morals. You know, story is there from the point of your children. At the end of the story, you have got a moralistic statement that is to be imbibed and followed and passed on to posterity in its pristine purity. Only then we can get the real crux and the gist of our great caliber and the great Indian tradition which have evolved. Subdued anger, who is contented? Most important thing is contentment. This is the test whether you are having mental peace or not. Those who are having contentment, they are definitely having peace, not otherwise. Bhogana bhukta vayameva bhukta tapo na taptam vayameva tapta kalo na yato vayameva yata trushna na jirna vayameva jirna. Bhartahari beautifully says, there is no end for this worldly pleasures. Once this is satisfied, automatically it paves way for another thing. You see, we think that how can I be in Bangalore? I say I require a house. All right, you have a house. Can I not have a car? All right, you have a car. What this Maruti 800? I say I should have Cadillac. I should have Benz. I should have Rolls Royce. When the car is on the move, I should be in a position to talk to the chauffeur with a background music. So that's the kind of thing. Where is the end for that? Material pleasures have no end. Therefore, those who are content in mind, they are the happiest people. What you wear is not important. How you feel having worn it, that's the most important thing in life. That's why Dushyanta tells, by looking at Shakuntala, even with a bark garment, she is so contented and beautiful. What happens to her if I adorn her with all the queenly robes? You see, she is the contented one. He praises. Mental contentment, they are the happiest people in the world. Adam Pratya Buddhi, that is what technically called. Sakappa Bhagavantanari Kotidana Ilbo. Nan Yavaglu, Meliro Ibur Nodbardo. Kelgada Iro Inurjan and Yak Nodbardo. Why can't I see 200 people who don't have even a single morsel of food? God has given me 2 morsels of food. I should be contented with that. They are the happiest people. Why did Mother Teresa build her ashram in Calcutta? Because Calcutta is a land of contrast. On the one hand, you have got palatial buildings. On the other hand, you have got people who are born on the street, who live on the street, and die on the street without ever seeing any roof over their heads. You know, the most important thing is in life, that contentment. That's why he says that anger and greed should be stopped. Contented and truthful succeeds in attaining peace. Truthful. The next point is truth. The most important thing is satya. That is what is lacking in the modern days. We have in Taittiriya Upanishad, Satyam vada dharmam chara matru devo bhava pitru devo bhava acharya devo bhava atithi devo bhava. This whole thing has changed. Satyam vada dharmam chara matru devo bhava pitru devo bhava acharya devo bhava atithi devo bhava. I am sorry if I am making this comment. I am very hurt. 1973, Bangalore University Convocation, Kantirva Stadium, December 31st, 12 o'clock in the afternoon, this is how Governor chanted. Satyam Vad, you are killing Satya, you are not uttering Satya. Satyam Vad. So, people who are in the helm of affairs, if they talk like that, what should be the condition of the graduates who are supposed to receive the degrees? And our national emblem is Satyameva Jayate. Only truth rhymes. Where we have put? There. Because below we can tell lies, you see. Therefore we have put there, at the top. Satyameva Jayate is only there, not here. So, always, truth will triumph. Kim Satyam? Shankaracharya asked this question in Prashnottara Ratnamalika. 64 questions, 64 answers, 64 hours of lectures to be given for 64 days in 64 weeks, which I have completed in Shankar Krupa, Jayanagar, 3rd block, number 45, 16th Main Road, for 64 lectures. What is Kim Satyam? The question of Shankaracharya. He himself asked the question and he himself gives the answer. What is truth? Bhutahitam. One who does good to all the beings. He does not say human beings, including the animals. You are not supposed to hurt any human being and not supposed to hurt any insect there. You know, Chandrasekhar Bharathi Mahaswamigal always used to look down when he used to walk. And the disciples used to ask, the place is so well known to you, Master, why do you look down? He said, look here, there is an ant going there. If I step on that ant, the ant will die. The God who has created me has also created that ant. If I step on that ant and kill that ant, I don't have capacity to recreate that ant. Therefore, I am looking down. He was always an introvert. If that statement has to come from him, what to say about us, the ordinary mortals? We don't even know that there's a creature there. We'll be stepping on that and we'll be walking as though nothing has happened. Satyam Shivam Sundaram. The most important thing is, what is truth is beauty, and what is beauty is truth, and that is inner beauty and not outer beauty, because outer beauty fades away always. Let me narrate to you one story from Buddha's life. Buddha had a brother by name Nanda. Nanda was madly in love with a girl called Sundari. Of course she was Sundari and not Dari. And Buddha took him on an evening walk. Some monkeys were jumping from one branch to the other. And he asked, how is that brother? He said, monkeys, come, let us move forward. He showed him a girl who was more beautiful than a heavenly damsel and asked him, how do you rate your Sundari on par with this Sundari? Now Nanda said, my Sundari now appears like that monkey you showed me. You see, all along your life, you were considering her to be beautiful. Now, when I showed you another girl who was more beautiful than her, she became monkey to you. Therefore, all physical beauty is like that. Only eternal beauty is the real beauty. Truth is beauty, beauty, truth, as kids would have it in Odin, a Christian earth. Therefore, what is truthful must be beautiful, and what is beautiful must be truthful. Brahmano nama satyam. Chandogya Upanishad directly says, another name for Brahman is truth. Therefore, truth cannot be painted over. George Santayana says in Theories of Beauty, you cannot paint over truth. Any time truth will come out. Truth will be out even if you bury the truth in a golden coffin. Russian proverb is there. You cannot permanently bury truth. That's why you have a statement in English. Who has the last laugh? Let him laugh in the beginning. Who has the last laugh? So that's the real test. Liars will survive in the beginning. A liar should have a very good memory. He should know what exactly is lied, because he will be caught up in his own lies otherwise. A truth teller need not have memory, because yesterday that is truth, today that is truth, tomorrow that is going to be the truth. Therefore, what is truth? Trikala abadhyatvam satyatvam. Truth is that which does not change from past, present and future. That's the real truth ultimately. Therefore, we say that Ashwamedha Sahasradi Satyamekam Vishishyate. This is a statement from Mahabharata, I am quoting. More than 1,000 Ashwamedha sacrifices, if one follows truth throughout his life, he is doing better service to humanity than performing a sacrifice. Therefore, truth has been given that much of importance in our tradition. Next statement, I come to that of Bhishma Parva, 26th chapter, 71st verse. Nirmamo nirahankaraha sashanti madigacchati. Who gets peace? Nirmamaha. One who does not have I and mindness. And nirahankaraha. One who does not have pride and ego. That's the ego should go, otherwise I don't go. And hence Ramana wrote a book, Erase Ego. I'm not talking about Arnold Schwarzenegger's eraser. Erase ego. You should erase your ego. Therefore, the most important thing to give up. People get ego on account of various factors. In psychology, they make a distinction between id, ego and superego. You know, some people, they have got superego, not just ego. Some people, they are very proud about their physical charm. They think that I am Aishwarya Rai. All right. After 15 years, with the emergence of Aradhya, Aishwarya becomes Shwarya. Of course, even now she is beautiful when compared to others, but not that original beauty. Therefore, physical charm has no permanent beauty. It fades away. Especially with the appearance of age, you see, age devours everything. That's why we say, Kalaya tasmai namaha, kalo jagat bhakshakaha. What happens when old age comes? Katram sankuchitam gatir vigalita prashta chadantavali drishtir nashyati vartate vajrata vaktram chalalayate vakyam natriyate cha bandhavajanehi bhagyana shushrushate hakashtam purushasya jirnavayasaha putropi amitrayate. All these happen in the old age. Katram sankuchitam, body becomes shriveled. Gatir vigalita, movement fails. Prashta chadantavali, teeth fall out. For children, ಜೊಲ್ ಸುರಿಯತ್ತೆ ಮಕ್ಕಳಿಗೆ. ಯಾಕೆ? ಹಲ್ ಬರದೆ. ವಯಸ್ಸಾದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಹಲ್ ಬಿದ್ದೋಗಿ ಜೊಲ್ ಸುರಿಯತ್ತೆ. ಜೊಲ್ ಸುರಿಯೋದು ಕಾಮನ್ ಫ್ಯಾಕ್ಟರ್ ಇಬ್ಬರಿಗೂ ಕೂಡ. ಅದರಿಂದ ಮಧ್ಯ ವಯಸ್ಸಿನಲ್ಲಿ ಇರ್ತಕ್ಕಂಥ ಯುವಕರು ವಯಸ್ಸಾಗಿರುವ ತಂದೆ ತಾಯಿಗಳನ್ನ ಮಕ್ಕಳ ತರಹ ನೋಡ್ಕೋಬೇಕು. ಓಲ್ಡ್ ಏಜ್ ಇಸ್ ಸೆಕೆಂಡ್ ಚೈಲ್ಡ್ ಹುಡ್. ದಟ್ಸ್ ವೈ ವಿ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ದಟ್ ಪಾಪ್ಯುಲರ್ ಸ್ಟೇಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಇನ್ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್. ಯು ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಬಿಕಮ್ ಓಲ್ಡ್ ಟುಮಾರೋ. ಡೋಂಟ್ ಥಿಂಕ್ ದಟ್ ಯು ವಿಲ್ ಗೆಟ್ ಅ ಸನ್ ಆಫ್ ದ ಕ್ಯಾಲಿಬರ್ ಆಫ್ ಭೀಷ್ಮ ಟು ಎಕ್ಸ್ಚೇಂಜ್ ಯೂತ್ ವಿತ್ ಯುವರ್ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್. ನಾಟ್ ಎವ್ರಿಬಡಿ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಬ್ಲೆಸ್ಡ್ ವಿತ್ ದಟ್. ದೇರ್ ಫೋರ್ ಸಮ್ ಪೀಪಲ್ ದೇ ಗೆಟ್ ಪ್ರೈಡ್ ಆನ್ ಅಕೌಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ their position. I am manager. Yes sir, definitely you are the damager. Therefore, you are not born as damager. After retirement, you are not going to be manager. Therefore, why are you hanging on to that particular post? We have the popular statement of Bhoja's life. You see, Bhoja, when he was young, his father died. And his uncle Munja brought him up. And he was envious. After me, my children should get the kingdom. Why I should hand over the kingdom to my nephew? Therefore, he thought of killing that boy. But Bhoja wrote a letter to him. There were so many kings, uncle, Mandhata, Mahipati and others. Nobody carried kingdom on their shoulder on their deathbed. I think you are going to carry kingdom also in your deathbed. Having seen that letter, totally his mind changed. He handed over the responsibility to his nephew and went away to the forest for doing meditation. You see, the most important thing is, we don't come to this world with something, we don't leave the world with something. Something we get in between, that's all. Therefore, let us not hanker around that. The third cause for pride comes on account of knowledge. I am very good. Self-righteousness is the greatest sin. If I think that I know 7 languages, Anand Kumar Swami knew 16 languages. Where do I stand in comparison with Anand Kumar Swami? You see, his father and mother, how blessed he was. Because his mother was British and his father was Ceylonese and he was an Indian. Anand Kentish Kumar Swami, who wrote more than 80 works on art, architecture, music, painting, what not. He has not touched. Aadu Mudrida Soppillanu Hage, he has commented on everything. But look at the humbleness of the person. You see, if there are 30 pages book, 60 pages will be footnotes. In 16 languages, you will get the footnotes. If you don't know that language, you will be outbowled, outnumbered and outcasted. Therefore, more languages you know, it's always advantageous. That's why Gandhiji used to say, love your mother tongue, don't hate other tongue. For some people, it's very difficult to know mother tongue because father tongue will be different, mother tongue will be different, there will be double-tongued fellows. Therefore, what is their mother tongue? That's the most important thing to gather. You know, people who know something about Sanskrit grammar, they can master German grammar very easily. Ekan, dve, trini, chatvari, pancha, shat, sapta, ashta, navadasha, eins, zwei, drei, vier, fünf, sechs, sieben, acht, neun, zehn. Zehn is 10 in German. And G-I-G-I, you write. How do you pronounce it in French? There was a movie by that time, 34 years ago in Rex Theatre. Some people said, jai jai, gai gai, gai jai, gai jai, ji ji. That's the pronunciation in French. G-I-G-I, you write. R-O-M-E, you write. How do you pronounce it in Italian? Italian is the most musical language. Roma, Venezia, Napoli, Ravenna, Pudova, Genova, Sudova. The most handsome people are Italians, probably with the exception of Sonia Gandhi. Nirmamo nirahankaraha. Therefore, ahankara should not come always. Chandrasekhar Bharati Mahaswami, in one of his discourses, says, O man, with which animal you are superior, tell me. If you think that you have got very good eyesight, eagle has got a better eyesight than you. You are worse than an eagle. If you think that you have got beautiful teeth like pomegranate seeds, what is the use of your teeth when compared to that of tusk of an elephant? Who cares for your teeth in front of the tusk of an elephant? If you think you have got beautiful hair, what is the use of your hair the hair of the goat or a sheep is made use of for the point of a woolen sweater, a woolen shawl. Your hair is useless. If you think you have got beautiful nails, you can play on veena. The nails of tiger and panther adorns the village folk deities as a garland. Your nail is not being made use of even for that. If you think you are very good looking, in a zoo, a peacock is protected, a lion is protected, and not a human being. Therefore, you are worse than all those things from the point of view of your physical sight. And if you think that you are very intelligent, can you compete your intelligence along with a jackal or a fox in deceiving others? Even deceiving others, you cannot compete with a jackal. That's better than you. What to say about cow? Everything pertaining to cow is beautiful. Therefore, try to learn with humility. Vidya dadati vinayam. Vinayadyati patratam. Patratva dhanamapnoti dhanadharmam tadasukam. Therefore, knowledge should culminate in wisdom and not in arrogance. Otta, 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 nangena gotila no gotakta hogutte. Adakke na odakke hogalla. ಓದ್ರೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗ್ಬಿಡತ್ತಲ್ಲ, ನನಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿಲ್ಲ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಗೊತ್ತಾಗ್ಬಾರ್ದು. ತಮಿಳಲ್ಲಿ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಕಾಗು ಗಾಗು ವ್ಯತ್ಯಾಸ ಕಡಿಮೆ ನೋಡಿ, ಬಂಗಾಳಿನಲ್ಲಿ ವಾಗು ಬಾಗು ಇರೋ ಹಾಗೆ. ಒನ್ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್ ಆಸ್ಕ್ ಮೀ ಇನ್ ಶಿಮ್ಲಾ, ಎ ಬೆಂಗಾಲಿ ಪ್ರೊಫೆಸರ್, ಸರ್ ಆರ್ ಯು ವರ್ಕಿಂಗ್? ಐ ಸೆಡ್ ನೋ ಸರ್, ಐ ಆಮ್ ವರ್ಕಿಂಗ್. ನಿರ್ಮಮೋ ನಿರಹಂಕಾರ ಸಶಾಂತಿ ಮಧಿಗಚ್ಚತಿ. ನೆಕ್ಸ್ಟ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್, ನಚ ಅಭಾವಯತ ಶಾಂತಿ ಅಶಾಂತಸ್ಯ ಕುತಸುಖಂ. ದ ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ಹೌ ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಯು ಬಿ ಹ್ಯಾಪಿ ವಿಥೌಟ್ ಮೆಂಟಲ್ ಪೀಸ್. The basic question which has been dealt in Mahabharata as well as in Bhagavad Gita. In Mahabharata, Bhishma Parva, 26th chapter, 66th stanza, and in Bhagavad Gita also this question comes. Ashantasya kutasukham. The most important thing which everybody aspires in life is shanti. That's why we end up, shantir me astu shanti. Let there be shanti for me. That's the most important thing which we aspire. And how was Ramana? ಶಕ್ತಿವಂತಮಿ ಶಾಂತಿ ಸಂಯುತಂ ಭಕ್ತಿವಂತಮಿ ಭೇದವರ್ಜಿತಂ ವೀತರಾಗಮಿ ಲೋಕವತ್ಸರಂ ಸಾಧುಭಾವಮಿ ನಮ್ರಚೇಷ್ಟಿತಂ. ಶಕ್ತಿ ಇಸ್ ನಾಟ್ ಫಾರ್ ಪ್ರದರ್ಶನ ಬಟ್ ಟು ಸೇಫ್ ಗಾರ್ಡ್ ದ ವೀಕ್. ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಯೂಸ್ ಯುವರ್ ಪವರ್ ಓನ್ಲಿ ವೆನ್ ಸಂಬಡಿ ಇಸ್ ಅಟ್ಯಾಕಿಂಗ್ ಎ ವೀಕ್ ಪರ್ಸನ್ ಟು ಸ್ಟಾಪ್ ಇಟ್. ದಟ್ಸ್ ದ ಕ್ಯಾರೆಕ್ಟರಿಸ್ಟಿಕ್ ಆಫ್ ಧರ್ಮರಾಯ ಇನ್ ಮಹಾಭಾರತ. ಡೋಂಟ್ ಥಿಂಕ್ ಧರ್ಮರಾಯ ವಾಸ್ ಎ ಕವರ್ಡ್. ಹಿ ನೆವರ್ ವಾಂಟೆಡ್ ಬ್ಲಡ್ ಶೆಡ್, ದೇರ್ಫೋರ್ ಇ ಟ್ರೈ ಟು ಸ್ಟಾಪ್. But if it was inevitable, he would go to the war, fight the war, win the battle and come back. That's why he has got a popular synonym, Yudhishthira. Please remember, this is one of the synonyms of Dharmaraya. Yudhi ranangane yaha sthiraha saha Yudhishthiraha. One who stays in battle firmly wins and comes back. He is Yudhishthira. He was not a coward. Shakespeare says in Julius Caesar, cowards die many times before their death. The valiant never taste the death but once. There is another poem of Hallvard the Hall which is called Valiant, being inspired from Shakespeare. Impact of Shakespeare and later literature, if one talks, one can take those points. So now, that is the characteristic of Ramana. Then what is the characteristic of Sadashiv Brahmendra? Shanta hankriti dosha susamahita manasa kopi purnendu shishirabhavaha rajatyananda satya chitrasikaha shanta ahankriti dosha varjitaha, who had not an iota of aham. You know, if you see the life of Sadashiv Brahmendra, it is such a characteristic way where the Guru Paramashivendra Saraswati used to stand and make Sadashiv Brahmendra sit at the top and give the discourse. And some people asked him, who is Guru, who is Shishya here? You are placing your student there and you are standing here and teaching him. Your student is mad. He is going from forest to forest with the help of Atma and Brahma. For that, the teacher said, how fortunate is my student. He has got the divine madness which has not yet come upon me. My student is the blessed and not me. Which Narasimhabharati Mahaswami records when he talks about Sadashiv Brahmendra in Sadashivendra Stuti 62nd stanza. He says openly that my student is the blessed one because he has got that God intoxication. You know, in Indian history, while writing, Huxley writes in one point, Kanaka and Purandara were God-intoxicated mystics with God-inspired composition, and hence they were nothing but godly. We require God intoxication, not any other kind of intoxication. Therefore, the most important thing for a person to achieve is shanti. To get that shanti, to get that peace, శాంతా మహాంతో నివసంతి సంతః వసంతవత్ లోకహితం చరంతః. శంకరాచార్య సేస్ ఇన్ వివేక్చూడామణి, లుక్ అట్ ద బ్యూటీ ఆఫ్ ద పోయట్రీ ఆఫ్ తకార ప్రాస. శాంతా మహాంతః నివసంతి సంతః వసంతవత్ లోకహితం చరంతః. సెవెన్ తకారాస్ ఆర్ దేర్. లుక్ అట్ ది కామెంటరీ ఆఫ్ చంద్రశేఖర భారతి మహాస్వామి గారు ఆన్ దట్. మౌలౌ మందాకినీయస్య మాలతి మాలికానివః మౌని మానసహంసోయం మౌఢ్యం హరతన శివః. ఇఫ్ దేర్ ఆర్ సెవెన్ తకారాస్ దేర్, దేర్ ఆర్ సెవెన్ మకారాస్ హియర్. దట్స్ ది క్యాలిబర్ ఆఫ్ ఎ కామెంటేటర్ కామెంటింగ్ ఆన్ శంకర. నో ఆర్డినరీ పర్సన్ క్యాన్ డూ దట్ కైండ్ ఆఫ్ థింగ్. Therefore, Shanti is the main thing which is required. Why United Nations should form from the point of view of Shanti? And why, after all, Krishna Menon should have given that 52 marathon lecture in United Nations from the point of view of world peace? That's the longest lecture ever being recorded. 52 hours non-stop on Kashmir problem, and he fell unconscious. Till he became unconscious, he talked and talked. That is Krishna Menon. These days, we don't have capacity even to talk for 52 minutes. He talked for 52 hours non-stop. You know, that is the caliber. Why all these things? From the point of view of Shanti. Shanti Duta. That is the name given for Gandhi in our tradition. You see, he was a messenger of peace. Shanti and Ahimsa are two faces of the same coin. That's why he said that there cannot be Shanti without Ahimsa, and there cannot be Ahimsa without Shanti. That is the need of the hour. And again, in Mahabharata, we have got some other statements. Jitatmanaha prashantasya paramatma samahitaha. Supreme soul is at peace and has conquered himself. One who conquers himself will get the peace. We always try to conquer others, but we never think of conquering ourselves. Because conquering me means conquering my own mind. The most important thing is to conquer one's own mind. Because mind is the most fickle. Therefore, it always behaves in a fickle way. Manaha, madukaraha, megaha, manini, marutu, ma, madaha, matsyaha, markata, makaraha, dashachandana. All the 10 things starting from the letter ma are known for fickleness. The very first thing is mind. You know, the most important question which Yamadharmaraya asked Dharmaraya is, what is the fastest moving thing? Immediately, Dharmaraya gives the answer, mind. Which one of your brothers who has become unconscious should come back to conscious state? He could have easily preferred Arjuna or Bhima. He says, Nakula or Sahadeva. Look at the wisdom of him. As son of Kunti, I am alive. As son of Madri, also somebody should be alive. You know, that is the Dharma Prajna of Dharmaraya. The most important thing. Therefore, to get that Shanti, one should always conquer oneself. Now, how to control mind? Science of mind control. R.M. Umesh, former professor of artificial intelligence at Madras IIT, has written a book called Science of Mind Control. The most important thing is, you can control others, but you cannot control yourself. Manomaya koshadinda velakobeku anta adike helu. There are panchakosha viveka. Annamaya pranamaya manomaya vijnanamaya anandamaya atmame shudyanta viraja vipapma bhuya sadga swaha. Psychologists stop at the end of mind. And beyond that, the philosophers go to the state of no mind state, which is a pristine pure state, and that is the stateless state, which should be your eternal state, on account of which you should always try in your own state. That is the kind where you have to go. That is called Turiya state. Shantam Shivam Advaitam Chaturtham Sa Atma Manyante Sa Vigneya. Shanta sthiti, when there is total silence. Shiva, where you find only auspiciousness. You see auspiciousness everywhere. You see good things in others. That's why we have the Shanti Mantra. Padram karne vishruyama deva. Padram pashye maksha vergidatra. Stirairangai estushtvagam sastanubihi. Vishema deva hitanyadayuhu. Swasti na indro vruddashrava. Swasti na pusha vishvaveda. Swasti na starksho arishtanemi. Swasti no brahaspatir dadhatu. Why Gandhi was at peace? Because of the three monkeys. You see, you should not hear bad things. You should not speak bad words. And you should not listen to bad words. If you can maintain those things, you can be at peace. Let me quote one modern illustration. Prashasya Mitra Shastri, professor of Sanskrit at Feroz Gandhi College, Roy Bareilly, in his work 1992, Komala Kantakavali, 32nd page, 4th paragraph, 2nd line, states, Gandhi re-emerges after 65 years and asks the monkeys,
I told you to close your eyes 65 years ago. Why you have not yet opened your eyes? The monkey says, Bapuji, what to see having opened our eyes? We see only violence here. Therefore, we have completely closed our eyes. The second monkey says, what to open the ears? I hear only bad things. Therefore, I have permanently closed my ears. What to say? Because they don't give me opportunity to say. Therefore, I have permanently closed my mouth. So this is the reaction of Gandhi's re-emergence from the modern poet's point of view to show that Sanskrit is not a dead language, but it's a living language. And those who think Sanskrit is dead, they are dead. Shanti khatgaha kare yasya kim karishyati durjanaha. This is the last statement which I want to comment. Udyoga Parva, 33rd chapter, 50th stanza. What harm can a wicked person do to a person who has a sword in his palm of tranquility in the mind? So one who has got that tranquil mind, no violence can ever do anything. In fact, Atankavada Shatakam, there is a particular century of verses on terrorism written by Mahamahapadhyaya Vagish Shastri, 32 bar 3, third cross, Shivala, Varanasi, 21002, 1972 publication, Vagyoga Chaitana Peetam from Kashi, where he gives what are the places where the terrorists put the bomb, how to counteract them and how to bring back peace. You know, when Rajiv Gandhi came to Bangalore, there was a board outside town hall. Do you want PACE or PASE? Very soon he himself became PASE with that bomb blast. The most important thing in one's life is that shanti. Shanti vandilde hodre yeni den prayojana jeevanthadu. Adike pratyobru ottadado nane manashanti kottupappa nanige neno beda anta. Therefore, let us pray Bhishma, let us pray Vyasa, and let us all pray all the great masters and the great rishis. We have given us the eternal peace with which we can be at home wherever we are. Om Sahana Bhavatu, Sahanau Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvinavadhitamastu Mavidvishavahai. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Friends, when I was speaking about Professor Ranganath, now it is clear that there was not even an iota of exaggeration. Thanks to Professor Ranganath, it was indeed a very wonderful talk on Mahabharata and peace. But when we speak of Mahabharata, it's an encyclopedic work. And so is the case with Professor S. Ranganath, who is a walking encyclopedia. His Upabrahmana from various other texts really illuminated the point. Sir, on behalf of all the donors and also on behalf of all of the people who are present here, we are very thankful to you for your wonderful talk. My sincere thanks to the donors of this program. Also, my sincere thanks to Shri Ram Prakash, Shri Pradyumna, and all the others who are present here for this evening's program. In fact, on Friday, 9th February, that is tomorrow, we have Srimati N. Sarojini Devi Memorial Endowment Program, a Carnatic Classical Vocal Concert by Kumari Apurva Lakshmi TV and Pachi. I request all of you to be present for tomorrow's program also. Thank you. With this, we come to the end of today's program.